B made me just fucking pastas, eh? It was awful. Hated it. Yeah. B, don't like pasta. Well, I do like pasta, but I just don't like what she made. Like ham and cheese and spinach in it. I was like, that's not a good mix.
It's just not right, is it?
No.
Fucking foreigners coming over here making our pasta wrong.
That should be the start. There's like a tagline to this, fucking foreigners making our pasta.
The thing that everyone's going to ask you, Will, Brexit.
I don't know.
Hello, my pedigree charms. It's my absolute honour to welcome you to the debut show of Burridge's Banter. Brought to you today by Master Republic, your number one source for online lucha goods and the greatest action movie ever made, because I made it, London Rampage, available now from londonrampage.com for only £1 to stream. Just £1, ladies and gentlemen. Featuring myself, Will Ospreay, Jimmy Havoc, all the top stars of British wrestling in a movie like you've never, ever, ever seen before. So check it out, londonrampage.com. Do you like this track that's playing? Check out Sustain on SoundCloud, my man. Let's get underway with our first podcast, Will Ospreay. Hello, fight fans, and welcome to Burridge's Banter. Is it Burridge's Banter or is it Burridge Banter? We haven't really decided yet. I think, what do you think, Will? Burridge Banter?
I like Burridge Banter.
I think Burridge Banter rolls off the tongue better. Yeah. So welcome to Burridge Banter.
We
got a very, very special guest with us today. A guy that needs no introduction, pretty much. We know who he is, but I will give him one. The aerial, I will give him one in general. But his introduction, the aerial assassin, Will Ospreay. Well done, yay!
Oh, yay!
Hello, mate.
We'll put like the applause of the people. They're all asleep.
The millions and tens and twenties of people we could fit in the resistance gallery. Thank you for being on my podcast.
No, thank you.
And I think out of everyone that I want to get on the podcast, you're like the main one, because...
Oh, thank you.
I'm just really proud of what you've done so far, you know? And this is like, I guess we could say this is your home, the Resistance Gallery.
This is definitely where I was made, I feel.
Yep. We kind of got that diamond and cleaned up that diamond and cut it.
I could do all the flips, but I could do none of the facials or the selling or telling a story.
Yeah.
This place actually taught me everything I knew, how to become an actual wrestler instead of just a gymnast.
So, like, today is pretty much your 1 year anniversary now since you got signed to New Japan.
Yeah, that's weird.
How does that feel?
It feels really good. It feels like I'm working with a good group of people to try and make something more than just professional wrestling. Like, because everyone these days would think, oh, you know, they hear wrestling, all they hear is WWE. And there's TNA, there's New Japan, there's Ring of Honor. There's so many choices now, but I feel like that core group of people in that roster are just all sacrificing so much of their bodies just to try and make New Japan like the top wrestling promotion in the world.
Yep, okay. When you say sacrificing your body, I know more than most people, you've sacrificed your body. Now, this is like, okay, listen, it was WrestleMania last week.
Yeah.
And I read on Facebook maybe a couple of days ago that you suffered an injury, IPW.
Yeah,
and I read it, I was like, every time I read your things, like,
I'm always injured, yeah.
Don't hurt yourself, please. I love you. Tell us what happened with your recent.
It wasn't like anything serious, and like, once again, everyone reads about my injuries and think I'm going to die. Like, I'm fine. Everyone needs to relax. I am fine. I just had another like little back attack, I call it. Like, I was Josh Bodum, Bubblegum, and Zach Gibson.
Yep.
And Josh goes for his like pile driver. I stop him. I tell Bubblegum to stay there, and I was going to hop on his back and moonsault off onto Gibson.
Yeah.
But it was just so hot in the London cockpit, and it's a theatre in the Marylebone.
Mm-hmm.
And I jumped on him. I just slipped off. Like, and normally I'd have the sense in me to go, I don't think this is going to work. But like, I got up on there a couple of times. I was like, oh, no, I think I could honestly do it. But I didn't obviously take in, like, we're going to be sweating. We're going to be all slippery. People wear baby oil.
Yep.
I was about to say Bobby oil.
Bobby oil.
I like that.
Good name for a wrestler.
But... Yeah. That'll be my new product I'll bring out. Brand new Bobby oil.
Will cosplay Bobby oil.
That'll be a tag team.
a little tip for pro wrestlers out there. You shouldn't be using body oil. You should actually be using coconut butter.
Yes.
You know that.
Yes, not slippery.
Yeah, it blocks your pores, so your skin can't breathe. But you get the coconut,
butter or oil, and you don't slip, you can hold better. You smell like a bounty bar.
You do actually, but like, because so many people say, I only put it on my front, and it's like, it doesn't matter. As soon as you get me in the waist lock, it's on my back. Mm-hmm. And then when we hit the ropes, it's all over the ropes. And like independent wrestling these days, they don't have guys going over with a towel. Yeah. So.
And if you notice, a lot of the ropes are this. You mix that baby off, it's going to slip easy.
Yeah. Like normal ropes slip anyway, so you can imagine cable rope.
Yeah, it's all these little things I think are overlooked. When people start off, obviously we don't have a lot of money as pro wrestlers when we start out. Little things like the wrist tape. Your wrist tape needs to be proper wrist tape made out of proper...
Oxide tape.
Not like electrical, your dad's tape. Plumber's tape.
The yellow and green tape.
Because that shit is useless. You can't grip, you know. And I was guilty of that. Nigel Beginners pulled me on that, to be fair. So.
Yeah. But, I used to do it when I was backyarding. And then I found loads on eBay. But now I just steal it from New Japan. They have like a big tape. That'll get out. If anything takes away from this, like, don't ever leave your tape
Will
around.
Will Ospreay fired for New Japan for duct tape, masking tape scandal. Let's talk about your backyarding history. Because you've no shame. You've come from a backyarding background.
I love it. I think it's really funny. Like today, actually, I was on the plane with Kenny Omega and the Young Bucks, and Kenny was like, Will, just out of curiosity, if I was to run a backyard show, would you do it? And I was like, yes, like, you call someone. Like, I love it. Like, I feel like people give it a lot of shit because obviously it is untrained wrestlers, and that's the thing I will give it shit on. But to give credit where credit's due, all of our guys were trained. We at least knew some of the base. Well, no, we knew all the basics. We knew some of the things what to do. It was just some of the things were quite stupid, and obviously the thing that gives backyarding its bad name is that like the drawing pins are barbed wire and like they're not getting paid for it, and that I don't agree on. But the things I do agree on, because like I fully admit, like I was backyarding like while I was doing gigs like Lucha, gigs like Progress, like I fully admit I put my hands up, and because my thing was that all my friends didn't want to go pro yet, they was quite happy like in the backyard. And I never got to see my friends, so like that was my social outgoings. Like, you're not going to tell a football player that he can't play in football in the field with his mates.
Yeah.
So I backyarded, and that's the thing I will say about it. Like, I don't regret it, but I wish I stopped it a little bit sooner because my body has suffered from it. But I loved it. I think it's a great source of like meeting new friends and networking and remembering that the passion is behind wrestling.
Yeah.
Like, it's never been about money for me. I mean, money's good. I love the money, but...
Well, it's a good way to look at it. This is how I first met you. Because we say we met at Dropkicks.
The first time we met was Dropkicks, and you was in the paper. And I told my mum, bring the paper because Darren Burridge wants to look at himself. And so she wrote that. But then I think we just went our separate ways. I started backyarding. In fact, the true story, John Ritchie kicked me out of Dropkicks because me, Scott Wainwright and Tim Lee were backyarding right outside his training school.
Oh, wow, I didn't know that.
And actually, like, and legitimately, wow, they were training.
Before we go any further, but backyarding, I'm always like, oh, you shouldn't backyard, it's naughty. And if you want to be a pro, you shouldn't backyard. When we used to train at Dropkicks, me, Terry Fraser, Shah Samuels, Liam, who's Mexican Eagle, who else? Martin Stone.
Martin Stone was the biggest backyard of all of us.
Like, we used to get on the train, the C2C, and have the C2C Hardcore Championship. And we used to kick the fuck each other on the way home on the train.
Martin's over there now, I'm going to tell you.
Everything we learned at Dropkicks, we would then got on the train and just kick the fuck out each other for the C2C. And it was an old... plastic WWE belt that had been cracked. And
so they put tape over the top of it, put hardcore.
Yeah, put like C, no, they put C to C across it, you know? But it's fun, man. It's like, okay, like...
It's not wise, that's the one thing I will say.
It's not wise,
It's not clever, but I get why people do it. Like, some of my mates are still doing it to this day. Like, I don't agree on flying yourself out to America to do it, but I don't judge them, because at the end of it, if it's their happiness and their money, then they can do what the bloody hell they want with it.
Because at the time, I remember I'd come down to your place in Raynham.
Yeah, the youth centre.
So basically you had a youth centre set up. Like with a ring.
Proper ring.
You had the backing of your mum, which is great. If you can get... That's the unique thing about you, Will. Like, you've got such a family following. Like, okay, went over your call the other day. And I just sat there and I just watched your dad, who's probably seen you like 100 times, like a million times probably. And he's always here front row at Lucha, cheering you on. always.
He likes the stairs.
Yeah, he was on the stairs, and you know, one of the nicest guys in the world. And I remember one of the Your Call shows quite recently, and your dad was at your merch table, you know.
Yeah.
And I was having a word with him, it was all good. And your music hit, and look how proud he was on his face. I looked at your dad and I went, oh, that's why I do wrestling. That's why I love it. And he's on the chair, he was like, getting the phone out, and he's like, you know, you could see he was like, that's my boy.
I think because he had so many people like say to him, like legit pull him to one side and be like, look, you need to sit down and talk to your son because he's never going to be a wrestler.
Yeah.
He needs to sort his life out. Like, mm-hmm. he needs to get a proper job. Mm-hmm. He needs to be an electrician like you. And my dad just went like, fuck you, he's going to be what he wants to be.
Yeah.
And he took me to drop kicks. And when he found out I got kicked out, I was like, you fucking idiot, what'd you do that for? But then he and my mum got the wrestling ring together.
Yeah.
And then when I saw someone nearly die, and I was like, all right, I'm not wrestling anymore. And then you got in contact with me and told me to come down here.
Yeah.
And he was the one that said, like, go do it. Like,
I mean, hands down, I remember before, I saw with Alex Shane, and you wanted us to train you guys. And I said, I can't train you guys if I know you're doing backyard. Because at the time, I was like, we can't be doing the pro moves, and, you know, because people can get hurt. It's a dangerous thing you're doing. But, I remember looking at a video of you. You must have been about four, I don't know. it was on MySpace. You must have been about four. It's a video on MySpace. You used to make these RCWA clips, and I remember seeing you. And I went, oh, that's the Will kid, and you did this move, right? And I shit you not, you did that spinning crescent kick from one side of the hall to the other. And I knew then, this is 10 years ago, I went, that guy isn't normal. He's not your standard wrestler. He's more than a wrestler. That guy has it. And I knew, I called it then. I mean, there's something about this guy that's more than just wrestling. You know, I could see it then. That one move, and Will, you must have been about 12, I don't know.
Probably 14, because that's when I started uploading videos.
You did about seven rotations, you know, into this kick. And then I started watching other stuff, and you was doing stuff with other horses.
Yeah.
Not real horses, like
gym horses. Not actual horses.
That would be sick. But,
get on a horse.
Yeah. There's a spot. That's not been done yet.
I'm going to do moonsault off a horse.
But I just
Where
knew
can
then.
I find a horse in Bethnal Green?
Well, we can find one. I'll find one. We've
just,
got an hour.
It'll just be you and Gary in a horse costume.
Mate, I'll do it. Just dress me out, I'll do it for you. But I knew then you were something special, you know. And did you know then you were something special? Or what? Tell me your mindset when you're doing all this crazy shit. And
quite a lot of people tell me I was special.
Right. Yep.
In the worst way. No, I don't know, I never really thought of wrestling. Because once again, like, I didn't even know there was a British independence thing.
Sure.
Like, I remember when I first started training here, and then you was like, oh, did any of you even come to... You were bollocking. I said, any of you even come to Lutz Potential? No, don't. I was like, I remember once when I was a kid, and I was like, oh, I don't really like this. Not my cup of tea.
Yeah.
And then I actually came to one when I was like 18. I was like, oh, this is cool. Like, look at all these characters and all that. And I just thought it was just like, kind of like shows like this. Mm-hmm. I remember when Gary's like, okay, you're going to be Dark Britannico and you're going to be the evil twin to Paul. And I was like, thank God, I love working Paul. Like, Paul's my favourite human being. And
you and Paul, in my opinion, are the two set out wrestlers. If Paul actually realised how good he was.
That's my thing with Paul as well. Because I just feel like
Paul, you're really good mates as well.
Have you ever seen have you seen Paul's recent promo?
His promo is so good.
The promos are the best.
It's so good, like. And you two alone, I just think you're more than world class, you know. Like,
I would have liked Paul to come over to Japan with me. Maybe we tag over there.
That'd be great.
I don't think Paul sees it like that. I think he sees it as like he makes more than enough money doing his gas work, and he's happy to have wrestling as his little side job. But I remember when you told me that, and it was like, all right, you're gonna make your debut at Brit Rest Fest.
Yep.
And I was like, I've never heard of such a thing. What is it? And I look and I was like, oh, wow, this is a cool venue. Yeah. And it was like, Alex Shane got us all together. He was like, right, guys, like, we've sold out. There's going to be more than 1,000 people. And I was like,
Which was day of WrestleMania, wasn't it?
Yeah.
The day of WrestleMania a couple of years ago.
Yes, it was the day of WrestleMania. And I was like, what the fuck? Like, I'm about to, I'm allowed to swear on this, aren't I?
Yeah,
oh, sweet. Fuck it. Right, sweet. But I was like, fucking hell, 1,000 people. Like, yeah. This is ridiculously nerve-wracking now.
Yeah.
And I always remember, because I was like, all right, as long as I do everything Greg says, because we was all here the week before and we was all practicing all the stuff.
Match down, like, wasn't we? Yeah.
Because we was like, oh, we might as well go in and try and steal it. Like, yeah. And I didn't know there was even any promotions other than Lucha. Mm-hmm. So seeing all this stuff, I saw Doug Williams and all that was mind-blowing to me. I was like, wow.
Liguero Doug. Versus Nathan Cruz, I think.
There was that. I think there was another guy now. I want to say Leroy Kincaid.
Probably. It was kind of like a showcase for the top promotions.
Yeah, and I feel like not enough of that is being done. I feel like there should be more of that. I feel like it would help British wrestling more if we all worked together rather than against each other. Yeah. But I just remember, like, we'd done our match, done everything, and the crowd were going nuts. Like, I've never heard a crowd like it before in my life.
We stole the fucking show.
And then I remember I came back and I was like, Jesus Christ, and then you came back, fucking yes! Yeah. That was the best!
We fucking
Twitter blew up. Like, that's the first time I ever heard of Twitter. Yeah. Like, as well.
That was the first time anyone had seen you in UK.
Yeah.
And I remember Mark Sloan coming up to me. He's like, who's the guy in the black mask? Oh, that's our secret weapon. That's
our secret weapon.
Will Ospreay. And the rest is history, right? Yeah. You know.
Just got on the booking scene from there. Yeah. You guys told me, right?
Go PW, Chikara go progress. As well. I think that helped. What do you think about?
Well, Chikara, no.
Getting seen in the UK.
I mean, I don't think Chikara helped that much because obviously, like,
what,
I came on the thing you think
that got you from the UK to the US?
Honestly, progress.
Sure.
Honestly, because when progress obviously became progress.
Yeah.
And it was just this punk rock, cool place to be. And I think when they put the title on me, especially after defeating Jimmy Havoc and Jimmy had that reign, I think it was that kind of state of like, all right, we want more British wrestlers. Who would you say are the top five British wrestlers? And I'd have to say, like, without being egotistical, I think I'm up there. I think Marty's there. I think Zach, Mark Andrews, and if I was to say now, Pete Dunne, probably we're probably the top five wrestlers in Britain.
I love watching you and Pete Dunne wrestle.
Pete Dunne's my favourite wrestler.
I think similar Henley, you've brung Pete Dunne up to the big
one. I would like to say I helped, but I think Pete Dunne and Frank, he'd done himself, but like...
Who's next, do you think?
I couldn't tell you right now, but
if
I... Maybe. I want to say I'd like Malik to succeed.
Malik, I think one of our London School Lucha Libre trainers.
And in Japan right now for the Kai and Tai Dojo. Yep. Next British wrestler, maybe Ashley Dunn. He's a good shout. He's a young kid. Like, well, not young, he's older than me, but he's
well,
a bit
Ashley's been
me.
Going for... He needs. Yeah, I think now is the time he needs to break out.
No, that's Ashley Dunn. You're thinking of Ash Draven, but I think he...
Ash Draven, sorry.
He's my mate. Yeah. Best man at his
Ashley
wedding.
Ashley Dunn, trying to think.
He was there when you came to see us all in that backyard youth centre. Right. There's a fly there. Oh, there it is.
He's got like some... Like,
weird emo fringe thing. He's in the pro scene now.
Yeah.
But like we done a show at, strangely enough, Elephant and Castle, the show that we done. Okay. And we just stole it. Me, Ash, Josh Wall and Scott Wainwright. And we just completely stole the show. It was one of the most fun things we've ever done.
Yep.
Like four reverse rounders.
As your mates. Yeah.
Yeah, it's all my mates. That's the thing that I loved about it.
Tell us about your debut for Progress. Do you remember that one?
I was teaming up with Alex Esmail, who was in the film Attack the Block, which is...
And what happened?
Which is a good film. I love you, Alex.
We love you, Alex, but what happened? I
don't want to blame anyone, personally, but when it was against the London Riots, and JD's so used to throwing men, and Alex is like a stick insect, and just threw him as hard as he could, and Alex's foot came underneath him and just snapped his leg in two.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, right, I've got to remember the rest of this fucking match now.
I was tagging with Marty Scroll on that show, and just someone coming back and going, Alex has broke his ankle. Because Alex was a very green, green wrestler, wasn't he?
Yeah, he was nowhere near ready, but like I got him on that show because once again, I've always treasured friendship more than... I like people coming with me. But I think it was just very clear of who, out of the two of us, who was going to go further as well.
In a way, do you think... Okay, like...
Because that happened,
the best out of a bad situation.
Yeah, because I feel like everyone then saw this 18-year-old kid just take this whole match on his back. Yep. Like, I literally... Well, the moment that happened, I said, if you can just roll over and tag me, I know this match inside out. Yeah. I done all of his spots, I done all my spots, I done London Right. I was calling to the London Rights what to do.
Yeah.
London Rights are awesome as it is. Like, so the fact that we gelled so well with each other.
Yeah.
I think, yeah, once again, we just made the best out of a bad situation.
Mm-hmm. Like, the thing about you, Will, I think you're autistic about wrestling.
Yeah.
You know, you watch in the ring, you're like another, you become another creature almost. And you just understand.
A lot of people think I'm on drugs when I'm in wrestling, but I've never touched anything in my life.
It's just amazing. Like you see wrestling differently, I guess, than others. And it's like it's so obvious that you're one of a kind, in my opinion. Dave Meltzer as well. He says pound for pound, you're the greatest wrestler in the world. I totally, totally agree with that statement.
I don't agree in it at all. Like, I mean, when you guys got like Kenny Omega and Okada and Shibata out mm-hmm. there, like I just think they're the pound for pound best. But like, I think what makes me unique is I can adapt to anyone's style. So like,
well, okay, look at that, because Phil, our cameraman here, he said to me earlier, he's like, I need you to ask a Will question. He said, the whole Will, I need you to shout, say it, because
I'm gonna ruin your podcast.
No, just do it. Shout it.
Like, you know how evolution wrestling for a long time was like, you could trace it back to like ECW?
Yeah, yeah.
He said that the next evolution of it, like what he saw was in one of your matches at WrestleMania weekend, where it was... It was like, the one we had a dance-off with like Drew Galloway, I think.
Oh, yeah.
That's the one that he was talking about when he said that like...
Yeah, that was last week.
This is the next like sort of level of it.
Believe it or not, that's just us having a laugh.
Yeah.
Like, that's just us having fun. That was the easiest match I've ever done.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But it's like, you are the next, in way I see it, you're the next evolution of a wrestler. You know, and you're, like, we had Johnny Storm and Jody Flash on the podcast, and it was like, the Americans were watching them and regarding them on that level as the next predecessor into pro wrestling, in my opinion, in terms of like, okay, you had Hulk Hogan, so to speak, as the top.
Yeah.
And then we went to say, some of the ECW guys like Rob Van Dam, he's leading the way. It kind of went
through this period.
Yeah, The Rock,
I think it just all changed when me and Ricochet done our match in the Best of Super Juniors.
You guys are the future of wrestling. This is, you set the lamp on this. This is the level that everyone has to get to now to become a professional wrestler. The outlook of what a professional wrestler is now is like kick pads, tights, CrossFit trained body.
Yeah.
Would you agree?
Yeah, I would say that. I mean, I'm not a CrossFit guy. I'm just a guy with just a lot of energy.
Yeah, like, okay, slim, athletic.
Yeah.
But young.
Yeah.
Very young.
I think the young guys are taking over right now. But like, I mean, somewhat I feel like it's the future, but I still feel like the throwback guys are like, I love guys like the Revival. And they're a proper throwback, Anderson, like the nitty-gritty. I love that style. And like guys like Shibata, who's like legit, who's like a hard motherfucker. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? But my style is more like along the lines of, I feel like if you went to watch a film and you went to watch Spider-Man, how boring would Spider-Man be if he was just like a grappler? Like, I'm just like, oh, no, I'm the Spider-Man. Like, of this.
Do you know what I do? Well, so for people that don't know, I made a movie called London Rampage. I've pretty much done everything. Wrote it, produced it, stunt coordinating. And I got Will in, yeah? And I was trying to sell it to Japan. And I was trying to sell it to other countries. And a lot of countries didn't really want to buy it because there weren't no famous people in it.
Yeah.
Yeah? And it was just at the time when you and Ricochet did that match and you did that. And it was all over the internet. You guys...
It went insane.
It went crazy. You know, if you haven't seen it off the rope stuff and the
Superman poems, yeah.
I fucking just showed them that all around the world. And I said, look, this is the guy who's in the lead character in my movie. And I showed him that, and I showed him exactly what it is now to be a wrestler in 2017. We're like walking superheroes. And it helped, you know? Because you are... It's like, people don't understand wrestling now. Like, especially the casuals, but when they see that, they go, wow, it's like superheroes.
Yeah.
It's like superheroes in tights, you know? And you can tell you've got a love for comic books. You can tell you've got a love for movies because of the way you wrestle. And I think that's what helps with your popularity as well.
I think somewhat of it is. I think, like,
because fans
the
are
cool,
social,
the cool teenagers and, like, the young adults like me, I think that... The old adults who are like, oh, we prefer the 80s and stuff like that. It's like, I'm never going to win those
guys. That's what I'm saying.
Like,
you're the new gen.
Like, I'm never going to win those guys over, ever. So, like, I'm satisfied with, like, being, okay, like, I'm that guy in the middle. Like, I don't want to say it, like, I'm kind of like John Cena. You either fucking love me for the hard work and stuff that I do for wrestling, sure, or you hate me because I'm not what a wrestler is. Like, a wrestler is meant to be 6'2", jacked, yep, tanned, cool hairstyle, and, like, I'm skinny, white, just below 6 foot. I just don't look like a wrestler. Oh, in fact, like, when I went to York Hall, the bouncer stopped me and went, this is only for wrestlers.
Yeah.
I was like, mate.
But it's about retraining.
The human mind,
The human mind. Because I do a lot of castings and they go, we want a wrestler. And you go, okay, well, I'm clearly not big enough because I know exactly what they want when I walk in.
Yeah.
Fucking Nacho Libre, yeah. Massive muscle guy doing like kind of poses, but like what I've noticed from seeing some adverts on TV and some promotional stuff, the idea now of what a pro wrestler is CM Punk. They like that. You got kick pads and pants. The modern perception of a wrestler at the minute is CM Punk.
Yeah.
It's still 5 years behind, pretty much, because the wrestler now 2017 is you. You know, and you did a Virgin. Active virgin trains, right?
With Tom and all that,
And they came in and they went, okay, this is what we want you guys to wear. And it was like, well, okay, it's cool, but it's like, this is what a wrestler is now. And we managed to get your ring gear on, and I think it helped. It helped retraining the public into seeing what pro wrestling is in 2017.
I don't think people believe my style until they see it live. Yeah. I think when they see it live, they are just like, how is this impossible?
Which is what we were talking about earlier, why we think wrestling is so popular now. But it's the same as music. The music industry is dead.
Yeah.
But people will go to the gig to see the band live.
Yeah.
People watch your stuff on YouTube and go, surely this guy ain't for real.
Yeah.
Let's go see him at our local. And it builds you up as a superstar online. So when you are in their town or your call, of course they're going to go, you can fill your call with like 2,000 people.
Yeah, I love your call. I think your call's probably one of my favourite venues I've done.
Yeah, I think it's my favourite venue.
Yeah.
It's so much history to it as well.
Yeah.
So, like, okay, so today you're off to your call.
Yep.
Who are you fighting?
Josh Bowden.
Yep.
It's a title for title match. Yep. He's the interim cruiserweight champion. I am the undisputed British cruiserweight champion, and fusing the two belts today because it's just designed to see who the best cruiserweight in Britain is, and I don't want to toot my own horn, but I already know it's me.
Yeah, well, the whole world thinks it's you. Kenny Omega on the show?
Yeah, Kenny's on it.
Kenny got signed? Has he signed to WWE?
No, 100%. He got the offer. He got the offer, but he's got unfinished business in New Japan.
Yeah, tell us about you in the WWE world. What's happening?
Nothing.
Yep.
Nothing.
Yep. What happened? What did happen?
Well, happened here, is it? When we was filming the Virgin commercial, I had a phone call, didn't I? I had to run out.
So tell the people of the internet exactly the story of what happened on that day.
So like Greg was saying, we was filming for the Virgin trains advert, and I had an email from him, but I didn't really think nothing of it. And I had my phone just like it's going now. And
it's not Vince, right?
It's not Vince. But it's like a missed call, and like it said underneath Stamford, Connecticut. And I was like, it's weird. It's calling me from there. So I called up. I was like, hey, this is William Ospreay. I don't know who this is, but you missed me. But if you can call me back at this time, like I'm free. As soon as I put the phone down, it literally just called up again. I was like, oh, shit. And like literally, I didn't know. It was like, all right. And he went, hi there, this is Stephen Regal. I was like, what the? I literally just started marking out. I started losing my shit. I was like, I've got to go. And everyone was like, no, we're nearly done filming. I was like, your filming does not matter compared to this phone call right now. And I ran out. And already I knew I was going to Japan anyway. But like, I spoke to him and he was just like, yeah, we're really wanting you to bring over. There was like, talking about the Cruiserweight Classic. We want to bring you over, but we need to ask this, this and this. Basically, loads of questions. I can't even remember what it was. But I said to him, like, how is this going to affect Japan? And he went, what do you mean? I went, if I'm going to be honest, like, I'm about to go over to Japan, I'm about to do this show, and I'm about to do the Super Juniors tour. What happens after that? And he goes, let me talk to Triple H and I'll get right back to you. And I was literally like, what the fuck is going on? Like, this is the most insane thing I've ever heard. Hung up the phone for a second, called back, picked it back up. He said, you know what, it'll be fine. In fact, he's actually willing to have you be a part of New Japan and WWE at the same time. And I was just started marking out because I was like, no one's ever done that. Yeah. No one's ever done New Japan and WWE at the same time. Mm-hmm. So the possibility of doing that was mind-blowing. But then just before I was about to go to Japan, they called me up and they said, we need to sign you to a contract. So they were going to sign me. And as much as I say, oh, the money isn't everything, no, the money wasn't good enough for me to move. I would have starved. I would have,
For what?
WWE.
WWE, okay.
Yeah. Japan were paying more than WWE. Right.
Yeah.
So, and although I always say that, money is not everything.
Yeah, we talked about this with the podcast with John and Jody. We said, would you sign to a WWE contract? And we said, what's the money like? And we said, well, sometimes it's not always about the money. You need to know whether you can hang in the WWE.
Yeah.
But in your, you know, I mean, when you're getting an offer from New Japan,
yeah, money. But like, and I think that was my thing because AJ put me over to New Japan.
Sure.
AJ yeah. Styles and obviously Okada and Gedo, because obviously Okada and I wrestled a little while ago, and then they were just like, yeah, this is the guy you want to bring over, he's the next junior heavyweight. And AJ even put me over as well. But I said to him, like, with all due respect, and I said these words, I was like, with all due respect, I want to come to WWE and be a big effing deal. I want to be like Finn Balor.
Yep.
I don't want to be like a guy who disappears on TV like a couple times and never hear from him again.
Yep.
So I would rather apply my trade over to Japan and then when I'm ready, come over. And then Regal said, maybe think about it. And then he called me up again and said, I'll just give a voicemail. I'm still on my phone. I'm not going to play it because I'm...
Sure.
But like, he was like, no, go to Japan, apply your trade.
This is Regal.
Yeah. And cool. When you're ready, you can come over whenever you like. Yeah. And he, even though I won the Super Juniors, came to Progress. That was when he disappeared on stage. And Jim Smore was like, Regal wants a word with you.
Mm-hmm.
Like before anyone was like, marking out over him, yep. Just going like, oh, can you give me some advice? And Regal's awesome with advice. He just,
yeah.
But Regal just told me like, you need to slow down because of X, Y, and Z. Like you don't want, like there's a reason why they do these long tours and then a long break,
yep.
Because it allows them to heal their bodies. And I was like, I do get it, but like there is so much work in Britain to be done. Like I keep saying this, like if I could stay in England as much as I physically could, I want to, because I believe so much in our little island, it is unreal. Mm. Like that World Sport TV that just happened a little while ago, British wrestling's off TV for 30 years.
Yeah.
And I feel like we're the generation that's like bringing British wrestling back to life.
Yeah, I feel that as well. It's kind of like, it's great at the same time. I feel like, okay, I remember like, this is an example, Flash Barker. I don't know why Flash Barker, but 2004, it was like, yeah, this is the generation that we're going to get on TV. We've done it. We've done Revival. And then I think of people like Flash Barker or someone like a World of Sport wrestler. And you kind of go like, just missed out. Just missed out, but I helped it get to there, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
And I always think of, and I think that's like, we thought we was going to get TV.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, we you guys were. You was on the wrestling channel.
Yeah, but it was not.
It wasn't mainstream.
It's not mainstream, you know? And the golden apple of World of Sport is there now. And I'm really happy I helped in some little way.
I think guys like yourself, Doug Williams, Johnny and Jody kept a pulse.
Yeah.
I feel like they don't get enough credit where credit is deserved.
Yeah.
Because no matter how good me, Pete Dunne, Marty, Zach are all doing, without those guys, I don't think British wrestling would even have a pulse right now.
No, it would not without Johnny and Jody. Johnny, they were saying yesterday, Johnny helped me so much.
Yeah.
You know? But like, the thing we were talking about and what I bring on to our next question, Johnny learned to slow down, so did Jody. They learned, once you've been doing it long enough, you learn what to do and what not to do. Now, it sounds to me, that's what's happening to you.
Yeah.
You're learning what to do and what not to do. So tell us more about...
Well, you know me, like, I like to obviously do stuff different all the time. I like to try and do stuff that makes people go, I've never seen that before.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. But after the accident I recently had, I have kind of been like, right, I now need to really slow down because my body is not able to take this much more. Like, I don't want to end up like every other flyer, like, you know, crippled. So my idea is to... Because I'm so adaptive, like, I can do any style. Like, I can do strong style, I can do cruiserweight, I can do technical, I can do submission. So, like, my idea is to try and maybe not start again. Like, everyone obviously knows my moves, but, like, try and add stuff in there that doesn't increase the risk.
Right.
So, obviously, that's something I've got to work out in the future because, like, to be honest, I don't know myself. I'm going to try some stuff out today.
So basically, like, what happened with me, I tore my ACL doing a dive for no reason against the Zeb kid.
Yeah.
Roy. And he was bent over. I should have baseball side him. I don't know why I did it. I went for a dive because I was stupid. I was a dive kid at the time, just doing stupid dives. And I dived through and I twisted, I landed and I just tore my ACL.
So it was like that and then went back.
Once you're injured, that's when you learn to work.
Yeah.
And what I did, I found, and Spud will say the same about this, you rely on character to get your point across in terms of wrestling. Do you think what we're going to see now is less of the aerial assassin and more of, say, character work, character building, gimmick? Are we going to see more of that?
I don't know because, like, once again, my character isn't me. It's just me just being me. Like, I'm an excitable, energetic kid. Like, obviously, I've got my dark roots and I've got my dark side to me, but, like, me personally is that I'm very proud to call myself a professional wrestler, even though that loads of people don't think what I do is professional wrestling. So I kind of want to go down...
Could you use that as an angle?
I think that's what I am going to do, because a lot of people just feel like, you know, what I do is not professional wrestling, but I live and breathe professional wrestling. Yeah. It's my heart, it's my soul.
Yeah.
Like, and all I just want to do is succeed in it. I want to help my friends succeed, and I want to help people that deserve it succeed.
Yeah.
But I don't want to... Put it this way, like, and this is not a shoot towards anyone, so please don't feel like it is, but I don't want to have to rely on a fur coat, an umbrella, mm-hmm. or a cool jacket, mm-hmm. or a mask, or edited promos, or anything along those lines.
Yeah.
I don't want to rely on stuff like that. I want to be the guy, if you took the fur coat away, if you took the umbrella away, if you took the jackets away, if you took the promos away, if you just leave it, and if I was standing there in black trunks and black kick pads and black knee pads, I'd still steal the show.
Yeah, okay.
My selling point is that I'm the fan that made it backstage,
mm-hmm.
and that's the way I want to keep it, because I love professional wrestling so much.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, it's obvious, totally obvious. Like, okay, the heat you had with Van Vader...
I mean,
was that legit or was it a
no? That was legit. That was 100% legit.
He didn't think it was a wrestler, did he?
No, he hated me. Like, legit hated me. And then, like, obviously saw a chance to make money from it.
Sure.
And obviously the things that have happened. Like, I mean, so many people told me just to beat him up. But then, like, the way I looked at it is, I was like, man, he's a 61-year-old man. Like, this isn't going to benefit me at all if I just kick the crap out of him.
Yep.
Like, but my thing is about it now is, I've said everything I want to say on that. Like, I don't like my experience that I had with Vader at all. Like, I feel like he could be handled in so much of a better light. But I don't believe in burying someone while they're really not well. Like, he's not well at all. He needs to...
He's got, like, a month to live.
Loads of people are saying, like, he's got a month to live. So I don't believe... And the fact is, I know deep down there's going to be some dickhead internet troll as soon as, like, something bad happens. It's like, oh, it's Ospreay's fault. It's like, piss off. Like... Literally, like, I bent over backwards that day. I done everything a guy should do.
Yep.
And I remained polite, and mm-hmm. I remained, as I always am, I'm mm-hmm. very well-mannered.
Mm-hmm.
So, but I don't believe in tearing someone a new arsehole when they're on the fucking deathbed.
Well, this is why it's called professional wrestling. Yeah. You know what I mean? I think this
I believe you're tearing people apart on Twitter, but...
This is why you can't call yourself as backyarder. Because this is pro wrestling. That's the word professional. Just doesn't just mean you're getting paid. It's how you act. It's how you work with your co-workers.
I think that's my main thing, yeah. I think that's the thing. We were talking about this as well, like, how people are acting in British wrestling. Like, when I first started coming in, I felt like there was a lot of people trying to hold me down.
I think there was.
And I don't want to say anyone, but, like...
You should have got... I think, personally, that your first 2 years in wrestling, you should have got pushed more. And it really angered me when I didn't see you getting pushed more. Or used wrong, or doing this, you know?
Yeah.
Lucky it's paid off.
Yeah, but, like, I just feel like my selling point was the fact that, like, once again, I'm the fan that made it backstage. I'm the kid that's happy to be here.
Yeah.
Like, okay. That's just my thing.
Good.
And I think if I can keep that up, like, maybe I'll start doing some cool bad guy stuff in the future. Who knows? But, like, I'm happy doing my stuff with New Japan and Ring of Honor. And then from there, I'm just going to just enjoy my time.
Well, the one thing I want to get you more involved in is the movie work. So you did London Rampage. Hopefully you get involved in the next one, London Fury.
That'd be cool.
Is there anything else that you'd like to do once you leave? Like, as you've left wrestling or you're thinking about leaving wrestling, any other areas of interest you've got?
No, I mean, like, I just, wrestling's my passion, wrestling's my one thing. Like, I love the movie stuff. I think I'd love to, you know what I'd love to do? I would like to be the first British wrestler on Strictly Come Dancing.
Well, there we go.
Honestly, like, I'd love to do that.
And you know what, you'd win.
I think I would. I think I'd wipe the floor with him.
Yeah.
Have that Craig Revel Hall.
If not, fucking shooting star, innit?
If in doubt, shooting star.
I just get sparred with bubble gum, you know what I mean? Bend him over, boom.
Yeah, oh, no, I'm not doing that. But no, I think that's just my one thing. I just want to focus on just being happy. And right now, I'm the happiest I've ever been. I can physically afford to look after my family.
Nice.
And everything in between, I am over the moon to just be alive, well, and living my dream.
Nice. I'm happy for you, mate. Everything you do, I'm just like, well done, Will. Just in whatever small way it was, I'm happy I helped shape you into what you are now.
I can't thank you and Gary enough for doing that.
Wicked. Thanks for being on the podcast.
Thank you.
Wicked.
Your call. Still a show again.
Blimey, what a pucker podcast to start off Burridge's banter. About some controversial subjects before, some things he's never mentioned before. Could we be seeing a new Will Ospreay in the next coming months? He mentioned that he's going to change his style possibly. Have we seen the end of the aerial assassin? Maybe just the assassin. His Rev Pro match with Vader being brung up. Vader suffering from congestive heart failure. Doctors saying he's only got 2 years to live. If anyone can prove them wrong, it's you, mate. Now, Vader's one of my earliest memories of pro wrestling, one of the greatest wrestlers to ever step in a ring. Vader, we hope that you can get over this illness. If anyone can get over this, I'm sure it's you. Now, if anyone has seen Vader before his WCW days in the Hanover German tournaments against Otto Wendt, guys, if you want to see a lesson in wrestling in Hanover, the Hanover tournament is a big thing in Germany in the 80s and start of the 90s. Just listen to the crowd. Listen to the crowd. Absolute geniuses at work. Sending our love to Van Vader. Hope you get well soon, mate. Lots of love from London. And a little story there, perhaps you didn't know, about William Regal ringing up Will Ospreay whilst he was at the Resistance Gallery filming a Virgin Trains advert. You hear it all for the first time exclusively on Burridge's Banter. Great to have him on the show. Had an amazing match with Josh Bowden. Josh Bowden, one of the great wrestlers to come out of the Brit Rest scene of late. Did you see Kenny Omega in the main event? Wow, what a show it was by Rev Pro over at Your Call. Now listen, join us for the next episode. We've got the legend himself. You may have heard him mentioned in the first podcast. Jody Fleisch will be joining us for the second podcast. Remember, Master Public Europe for your top lucha action and londonrampage.com. Come and see the action movie that Will Ospreay made his movie debut in. It's an amazing movie and it's available for just £1 streaming. You look at what the wrestlers do and you think, do you know what? I'd like to give that a go. Then come down and join me at the London School of Lucha Libre on a Monday, £10, the home of Will Ospreay, where he learnt his craft and doing what he's doing now. He learned how to do it at the London School of Lucha Libre. Mondays at 10:30. Only £10, ladies and gentlemen. See you there. The Resistance Gallery, the top venue for all you London maniacs. If you need a venue hire, come and join us at the Resistance Gallery. Ladies and gentlemen, it's been my pleasure. What a great episode. Great first Burridge's banter. Please send us in your questions. Send us in your opinions. Did you like the show? Did you not like the show? Send in your banter, ladies and gentlemen. Send a message to the Facebook page, Burridge's Banter. That's Burridge's Banter on Facebook. Hashtag Burridge's Banter. Burridge Banter. We've not decided yet. Is it Burridge Banter? Is it Burridge's Banter? What do you think sounds best? Hashtag Greg Burridge. Hit us up on social media. We're all over that. Twitter, Facebook, Instagram. And join us for episode 2, Jody Fleisch. Bye.